puzzle from one of the greatest puzzlers of the last two centuries, perhaps. That's putting it out there. There's a guy called Sam Lloyd. You can look him up. This is one of his most famous puzzles, and he patented it and sold millions of sort of physical copies. So I've made myself a physical copy. It's quite hard to get the originals, and if you do get an original, worth a lot of money. The puzzle's called Get Off the Earth. The center bit moves, and I just made it with a paperclip and printed this out. But the racial stereotyping kind of want to move away from. So there are some equivalent puzzles, which I'm going to show you. I made the digital copy, and I found one that Sam Lloyd also made to do with a bunch of bicyclists. They're boys with flags around a bicycle, and it moves in a similar way. I invite you to count the number of cyclists around this wheel.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13.
Not rocket science. On card, I'd just be spinning the inner wheel, and the same question now, Brady. Count them. Where do you want me to start? Same.
The B.
Okay.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12.
I can see his face. The text underneath says, turn the disc so the arrow points to A and count 13 boys, then move the arrow to B and there are only 12 boys. So they agree with what you've just said. And the question is, which boy has vanished and where did he go? Let's just check.
Count heads.
Okay, we'll count heads. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Definitely 13 heads. Shift it around. Heads, yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 heads. Do you want to count legs?
I don't think the situation's going to change. I still think it's something to do with the way the boys are drawn, but...
Something to do with the way the boys are drawn. Do you want to say more about your instincts here? You've got good instincts today, Brady. Your instincts are important. So what is it about the way they're drawn that you think you're suspicious about?
I just think something that was a head turned into not a head, like a shoe or something.
Really?
Yeah.
I mean, let's find a candidate, right? So this head gets cut in half, but then there's a bit of a head here that it kind of joins with, right? It joins up there, and it got, you know, replaced the other half of the head there, and this one gets lost a bit, but they're still there. Some funky things are going on. This leg here, I think, is a left leg, and when I slide, it's now a right leg. That's interesting. I don't know if that messes up your count, but I mean, it shouldn't change how many heads there are, in my opinion.
The key is there where the two are together.
There's some, here.
That's got to be key.
Well, but there's still two heads, right?
Yeah.
And they're just separated. There they are. They're still there. There's nothing tricky going on.
But it's... I think that's the key.
This is one of those puzzles that's frustrating, and it caused a stir back in the day, because... It feels so simple. There's nothing tricky going. It's a piece of paper. You can actually touch it. You can move it around. There's nothing to conceal, really. But something surprising is going on. You start to doubt your counting ability. You start counting from different places. You count the heads. Maybe you count the flags. And it's one of those puzzles that feels insulting to your intelligence. And that's why it splits people into, like, really annoying, something tricky is going on, and fundamentally doubting the very core of your being. Like, I can't count to 12. Nothing should change when you spin that. So there's something subtle going on, and I thought I'd explain it. There's some other variations of this puzzle I thought you'd show you. So Martin Gardner wrote about this one, and I found one that he made. This time it's not in a circle. Let's do some counting together, Brady. How many faces?
6.
I agree. How many faces?
5.
So which face disappeared?
I mean, there are still 6 hats.
And I can shift back.
But there's only 5 chins.
Well, the chin's just a horizontal one there. The first thing to comment is that, like a magic trick, this is done less as a magic trick, more of just like, what's going on? But that's what a magic trick really is. The question of how many faces is a valid question, but it has two different answers in the two configurations, in the spinny version or this version. The second question, which is, where did the bicyclist go? Which one disappeared? Or which face disappeared? Or which face appeared? That's the misdirection. I think that question is invalid. And that's why you should ask it, to sort of apply this direction. Because if you ask someone to describe what happens to the faces, you get a different bit of attention. Tell me about these faces, maybe compared to those faces. Maybe tell me about the height of them.
They're different heights.
They're different heights.
Yeah.
In fact, they're different faces, right? None of the original faces are still there. There's 6 faces. None of those faces exist anymore. There are 5 new faces. So that's why that question is misleading, I think. Which face disappeared? All of them. And we made 5 new faces, which are fundamentally different. In fact, they're a bit longer. Do you begin to see what's going on? When you simplify it this much, it begins to get insulting. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Agreed?
Yeah, all right.
So in the other puzzles, I shifted something. I'm just going to shift something on this diagram. Now, I know you saw what happened, but how many lines are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And there were 11 just now. I'm going to go back again. 11 lines. Which line appeared, disappeared, is a nonsense question. Agreed?
I don't really know. I'm kind of baffled.
This is so simple that it's baffling. There are definitely 11 lines here. And what I've actually done is I sliced them along that line, and I just shifted everything along that line, slid it there. And now there are only 10 lines, but they're all a bit longer. So which line disappeared? None of them. That's the effect we're happening. When you say which line disappeared, well, this is a nonsense question. Actually, I've just made 10 new lines from bits of the old ones that are a bit longer. So imagine that situation, put the lines at different heights and slice horizontally. So here's it's just another version of the same thing. You count the lines, but then you shift them. Different number of lines. Some of them are different lengths. I've done this randomly, and now it's really obvious that some of them have fundamentally changed. It's just a different set of lines with a different number going on. And that wouldn't be impressive to anybody. What you could do, though, let's work this around a circle. Like the first two things we saw were done on a circle. So it's basically taking that line that I've sliced some lines and wrapping it around. And you can see that I get a rotational thing here. So let's just count the lines here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And they're all certain length. If I then switch it around, we have a little bit of a conflict. You can see there are two lines next to each other. They could be counted as one line, but if they were more identifiable, you could see that they're two different lines. There's two lines of roughly that length. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. If you start getting clever, wrapping this cut around a circle and realizing all that's happening is you're making new lines appear which are slightly longer. And if they're not a lot longer, they look very like the old lines. You get a little glimpse of what an artistic version of this could look like. So we'll go back to the face. Imagine these are lines, there are six lines. And if I shift them over, now there are only five of them. But they're all a bit longer. And so if you design the faces cleverly, this guy, his eyes are there. They look a bit like eyebrows, but they actually become eyebrows on this guy's face. So there's some artistic cleverness to make the identifiers a little bit subtle. And now there are five faces where there previously were six, but they're different faces. They're all a bit longer. It's exactly equivalent to the lines. And if we go back to our bicyclist, we've gone back to the circle idea. We've drawn 13 boys, and you can see that they're getting further and further in on the circle, a bit like our lines got shifted. And when you shift it, we're just splicing together bits of boys. All the boys disappeared, and 12 new boys appeared, which are all a bit longer. But they're designed artistically enough so that it's really hard to tell. On a bit of paper, everything's slightly imprecise, and artistically, we forgive any sort of slight misalignments. And there are quite a few.
So tell me, with the boys, where did the 12 to 13 heads change? Because heads aren't lines.
Heads aren't lines. But there are definitely 13 heads, except some of them are very clear heads. And obviously they're not changing. This one up here is not changing. And the ones inside are not changing. But the crucial thing is around these edges where the head is intersected by the line. That's where we splice together bits of two other heads. And the new head we get is slightly longer or slightly shorter or just slightly smaller. And if you like, you can see that this guy's head here is quite fat. And when I shift it, it's even fatter, like a super fat head. And that's happening in a subtle way all around the body parts, the legs, the heads. This is a really lovely mixture of a really simple piece of maths, like you can splice lines and they look similar but a bit longer, done artistically into a way that completely bamboozles clever people who have their wits about them. They know how to count to 13 and 12, and yet that little shift changes the fundamental reality of the number here. It's a nice example of a puzzle that's been around a long time, but even when you understand it, there's still something slightly bamboozling about it.
A great thing about the puzzle in today's video was how it was interactive. You could slide it back and forward, look closely, like on your own terms. And that's also a great thing about the courses on Brilliant, today's episode sponsor. These are from Brilliant's pre-algebra course. As you can see, pretty interactive. But as you can also see here, there's plenty more where that came from. If you want to get smarter, to give your brain a workout that's both fun and educational, you can't go past Brilliant and its huge range of courses, puzzles, daily challenges. A Brilliant premium subscription, which unlocks all this great stuff, is also a great gift for youngsters and lifelong learners. Go to brilliant.org/unmade, it's there on the screen, for 20% off that subscription. You won't regret it. Our thanks to Brilliant. Special thanks to these people for supporting us on Patreon. You can join them. Go to patreon.com/numberphile. But not just them, thanks to everyone who's taken the time to watch this Numberphile video.